Please welcome to the stage Ruth Simmons and Darren Walker.
Hey,
thank
you.
Okay. Wunderbar. I'm on the right. Is that right? Right here?
Yes, you are.
Okay.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. And welcome to the Ford Foundation for this special treat. An icon, a trailblazer, a badass, a woman who has written this memoir, Up Home, which is poignant and profound, deeply personal, authentic, filled with integrity, great writing. And it is, for me, such a look at the interior of this young girl who lived in a small East Texas town, something I can relate to.
Yes.
And endured some pretty, just, I think, some would say almost insurmountable barriers to advancement. And yet here you are, this person of remarkable success and achievement. We have lost count of the numbers of accolades that start with the first. But let us get right into this book. And for me, there were so many moments in it as you reflected on your life. And this book is not a memoir. I was a little girl. I went to a Dillard, and then I was at Princeton, and then I was President Smith, and then I was President Brown, and on our fabulous. This book is not really that. This book is just, this takes us to the moment at which you've been accepted to Harvard and you are about to leave the South for good. Mm-hmm. But let's talk about the very beginning, because the beginning is, it's really beautiful. And I love how much you loved your mother and your grandmother. And I love how you used to get whoopings, which I used to get whoopings too, from those who loved us, who now would be charged by Child Protective Services. But anyway, that's not what we're here to talk about.
But I was terrible. That's, you know.
You were not terrible.
I was insufferable.
So talk about that beginning. And of course, it's been written about everywhere, the way you describe your life and your beginnings. I was born to be someone else.
Well, most people today have no sense of what it was like in the 40s and 50s in the Deep South, and I sort of include the Southwest in that. If you were black and you lived on a plantation and were a part of the sharecropping system, of course, many people in Texas and across the South are aware of that culture. But we lived it, of course. And essentially what it meant is our family lived on a farm that utilized the labor of every member of the family to work the crops and pick the cotton. But in exchange for that labor, one got kind of minimal living accommodations, but no opportunity to amass any means of getting out of the system, basically. And so it was, for my parents especially, And for my older siblings, a very tough existence.
You had 11 siblings.
Yes. And of course, they were all working in the fields. And so, but for me, being the last one, I just reveled in the fact that I was surrounded at all times by my family. So every day, all day, whether at our home or whether in the fields, we were all together. And I recognize now that that had a profound impact on me, the fact that everyone was together and that family bond that formed. It was so important in order to survive the daily denigration that we experience in the face of the terrible segregation and discrimination that existed at the time. So that was our comfort. And so my mother especially meant so much to me because she had nothing really at all. She was a woman of her time. She was very subservient to my father. And she had nothing for herself. My father was always very well dressed and very proud. And you know, you may be aware that there has been a time in the African American community where African American women were expected to stand back and to allow men to have all of the glory, everything. And black women often went without and thought that was the way it was supposed to be, because women were supposed to be a man's helpmeet. And they used that all the time, that term all the time in black churches.
In churches, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Supposed to be the helpmeet. They would
exactly
preach that.
Exactly. Your role is to be a help.
Yes.
To the man of the house.
But she was, in spite of that, herself, an enormously generous person.
But you also say that you learned, among many things, this idea of discernment.
Yes.
That your mother was a very shrewd, discerning woman.
Yes, she was. But I didn't understand how she was able to discern the things. But she was very firm in her views of people. Some were worthy. Some were not to be associated with under any circumstances. And it went so far. It was just fascinating to me when I was small, and it was very frustrating to me. We'd have picnics on the grounds of the church. And it was made very clear to me that there were some people whose food I could not touch. And I, you know, because they were unworthy. And apparently that extended to their food. If they were of low character, their food was not to be eaten.
That's right.
And so on. So, but she talked a good deal about human beings, what made a good human being, what made a less than good human being. She talked about what she expected of us, never to think of ourselves as being better than anybody else, always respect others, always sacrifice to give to others because they might need it more than we needed it. And it was very frustrating because, as I've said, we'd go to people's houses occasionally, and she'd forbid that we partake of anything at that house because they might need it. But when people came to our house, she gave them everything we had, and we had very little. So
well,
we were
say,
really
I mean,
angry about
of
that.
Of course you were. And because you literally were not eating all you wanted to eat.
No, I was hungry. And people would come to the house and she'd give them all of our food because she thought that they might need it.
Well, and between her doing that and your father eating all the good food.
Eating all the good food, exactly. So there was nothing left. And I was the youngest, which meant I got the most, whatever was left. And for me, that was chicken feet.
Oh, which is why I can't have chicken feet today. I mean, no. Right?
Right.
No.
So that's what I got. I got chicken feet. But I became enamored of chicken feet.
You did?
Mm-hmm. And because I apparently once in Well, I was little. So in church, I started crying out for chicken feet. I was hungry. I wanted chicken feet. And Miss Mary Isidore, thereafter, every Sunday, brought me chicken feet. And so, you know, people still ask me about chicken feet.
But you don't eat chicken feet today.
Oh, no.
Okay,
no,
good.
No,
I just want to be clear. No. because no. I too grew up like that. And all that being poor and all that bad food that we had to eat, I call the slave food, all that horrible food, I would say that my family would eat, my mother, I mean, they would eat children, they would eat, you
anything.
Know, chicken neck, they would eat all the stuff, of course, that
of course.
I just... I abhor it all today. I mean,
you
I couldn't
do.
Imagine.
Well, I don't abhor it all.
Oh, I do.
No.
Oh. I have a friend. I have a friend whose name I'm not going to say, but he literally grew up at this from the South like us, and he, you know, was a partner at a big firm and lived in a big apartment on Park Avenue. And one time I went to visit him, and I got in the elevator, and I smelled something, and I thought, it cannot be.
Chitlins.
I opened the door and I said, "Have you lost your mind?" and he said, "You are so sedity. I am not. I still am who I am."
Yeah, yeah.
But you live on Park Avenue. What the hell are you doing cooking chitlins? This is like.
Well, they're regarded as a delicacy.
Oh, by the French. Okay, so let us. So you have a passage here that I love. That I love. Where you say, "Mama and Daddy taught us at a young age that any area we did not know could be dangerous for blacks. Stops for gasoline, water, and restrooms had to be plotted carefully with specific intelligence about which places served blacks." So your own little green book.
Right. Yeah. It was quite dangerous to stray off of certain paths because, you know, segregation was an extraordinary thing in this country because while it wasn't written that blacks could not do X, Y, and Z, everybody knew it. Because it was handed down, I suppose, from one generation to the next, that we'd better not do certain things, and it was not only just that we couldn't go to the movie house, we couldn't go into a restaurant, we couldn't go to the same places that whites could go. That was understood. But what was not as well understood, and is not as well understood today, is how dangerous it was to go. Because you could be summarily punished by almost anybody for stepping over the line. And that was unforgettable, frankly, that the world was that way. There was I'll send you a picture of this, but when we would go into town, we couldn't go into restaurants, but we could buy food. And there was a place that all the blacks would gather for their picnic or lunch. It was called Buzzard's Roost. So we were buzzards, okay? And that's the way we were treated.
Mm. So talk about Miss Ida Mae Henderson.
Miss Ida Mae.
She changed your life.
She did. You know, growing up without any amenities, no electricity, no running water, no books or anything of that kind. It was a rather somber reality, especially indoors. And yet the first day I walked into my classroom and I saw these bright lights and was shown to a desk that would belong to me with utensils and books, I thought. Remember now, I'm the 12th, which means I have no rights and I have no space in my home. And so here now is something that belongs to me. So, but that wasn't all. He was an educator who welcomed me, a very country child who was often ridiculed for the way that I looked because we didn't have store-bought clothes. And so here is this country child coming into the classroom, and she treated me as if I was a princess. And she said, come in, baby. Here's your chair. And then when it started and I learned that I was going to be able to have books and I was going to read, and she was going to constantly tell me how wonderful I was. Well, I mean, really, in my household, I was a nuisance. And so I was always, oh, God, do we have to tolerate her? I mean, you know, we had enough children already before she came along. Mama, can you tell her? She's very weird. Can you tell her to go somewhere and sit down? So that's what I'm getting at home. I get into this classroom, and this woman is saying that I'm wonderful. But more than anything, she showed me that learning was a supreme privilege and joy. From the time I stepped into that classroom, I never forgot that, and that was going to be it for me because it was a wonderful experience.
But you talk about her as the first professional Black woman
Yes.
you encountered.
Yes.
And you speak of her bearing, her sort of pristine
Yes.
sort of way in which she projected herself, her clothing.
Yes.
That clearly left an impression.
Yes. Well, because I didn't know Black people could be like that. So we're on the farm, and we see people dressed in clothing that's been crudely made from flour sacks or whatever was available and so forth. And we didn't see people who were composed and stylish. And then the other thing that struck me greatly was the way she talked. Here was a woman who talked with so beautifully.
You talk about her diction.
Her diction. I mean, really, that I thought, if I could only talk like that, something good could happen for me if I could talk that way. So, you know, all of that is to say she was a model for us country children. And that's why when I talk to teachers, I always say, you have a responsibility every time you walk into a classroom, every time, to remember that children are looking to you for their inspiration. And that means you never get to have an off day. You never get to be depressed or sad. And if you don't know how to act, learn now, because you have to go into the classroom convincing them every day that life is wonderful and the future is going to be grand.
And so you go from Miss Ina May's class, you go to junior high school, your family moves, you go from small town country girl to the big city, to Houston.
Yes.
Where your junior high crush is none other than future Congressman Mickey Leland.
Mickey Leland, my heart.
You were in love with Mickey Leland.
I was totally in love with him. And do you know, I mean, even today, at an event last week, I ran into his wife,
Allison.
And I resent her.
You resent Allison Leland?
Well, she's lovely, but
she's
that's not the point.
She's a lovely person.
She's a very lovely person, but yes.
He should have been yours.
He should have been mine.
Okay. Well, we weren't expecting that audience. Okay. So you do find yourself at probably the most famous Black high school in the South.
Could you say that again?
The most famous Black high school
there you go.
In the South. Phyllis Wheatley High School in Houston, Texas.
Not Jack Yates.
Not Yates, their rival.
No.
Phyllis Wheatley. Phyllis Wheatley, of course, talk about badass women. Okay, let's talk about. And there you are. Do you believe, as you, well, you seem to imply, and I want you to share, that there was something magical about Black public schools with Black teachers, Black principals, Black excellence.
Yes.
You speak of that in almost romantic terms.
And most who were in that era would agree with my characterization of it because we were so fortunate. And it's unfortunate that Blacks at that time had very few choices for careers. So as you might imagine, the best of the best went to teaching because that was one of the few professions they could follow. And we benefited so greatly from that because they were phenomenal practitioners. They were phenomenal human beings. And the thing that, again, was so extraordinary to me is how much they cared about us. They cared about us. They pushed us. They insisted that we could do more. They insisted that on something that we did not believe, and that is they insisted that we should prepare ourselves because the future could be better. Well, who was going to believe that? We're walking down streets in Houston, and people are driving by in cars and calling us niggers. We can't go downtown to department stores. We can't do anything. And they are envisioning a future for us that we dare not envision for ourselves. So they gave us that vision of a future. Oh, my God, what a thing for them to have done.
And yeah. Your point is so well taken because that Black woman who was a teacher a generation or two ago today would be at Harvard Business School going off to McKinsey.
Yeah. For example.
And let us celebrate progress and also understand the consequences mm-hmm. of progress. So how do you, when you think about the next period, you actually wanted to be an actress?
Yes.
You were going to be Dorothy Dandridge.
Or better.
And so Ruth Simmons. You went to one of the great historically Black colleges. You left Houston for New Orleans and Dillard University.
Yes.
But you got to Dillard, and of course you excelled. You did well. You were, the accolades started to come your way. But you didn't really like Dillard that first year. And you got into your head by that second semester that you were going to transfer.
Absolutely.
And that you were going to transfer to this women's college called Sarah Lawrence.
Yes. Why not?
And what happened?
They accepted me but gave me no financial aid.
And so you found yourself back in New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
But then something else big happened.
Mm-hmm.
You were chosen by the university to represent at a program that brought you to Wellesley College.
Yes.
Talk about Wellesley College, because your book clearly indicates what a sea change that was.
Well, I mean, it's generous to say that they sent me there, but they really wanted to get rid of me. I was obstreperous in the extreme as a student at Dillard. I was opinionated. I was an activist. I critiqued everything at the university, and I boycotted chapel.
So they were like, send her to this white girl school.
Yes. They definitely wanted to get rid of me. But it turned out to be a wonderful experience for me because for two reasons. First, it was very challenging academically, and I needed that because I labored under the fear that I really wasn't that smart, in spite of the fact that my teachers were telling me I was. I just didn't think that that was probably true. But I landed in this very challenging academic experience alongside very elite women, wealthy women. And I had a chance to see myself in comparison with them. So that was number one. But number two was, I'm still under the thumb of patriarchy so thick from my home to Dillard, okay? Because we're still saying, well, let the boys win, you know, stand back. But darn it, Wellesley had a woman president. A woman president. I couldn't get over that. Women can lead. They can. And so I took from that a lesson about how to view my home culture and what needed to change about it. And I also took a lesson about what I could aspire to do. Because I'm still, remember now, when I'm growing up, I'm thinking I'll become a maid, okay? So that's my, that's I won't call it an aspiration, but that's my assumption that I'll do something like that. Then I graduated to, maybe I'd be able to work in an office, maybe. But I'm not anywhere near this, oh, I can innovate. I'm creative. I can do these things. I can lead people. No, I'm nowhere near that. But when I see Margaret Clapp, I think, oh my goodness, that was such a powerful example for me.
And even though, I mean, she was herself a privileged white woman.
Yes.
You could relate.
As a woman, yes.
And I think it's important to note that that's correct.
Right.
As a woman, you could relate to her regardless of her race or her background.
Yes.
And speaking of being a maid, you were a maid at Wellesley. You cleaned houses.
Yeah.
Because you had to make money.
Yeah, I had no money, so yeah.
And the patriarchy that you speak of was truly, in some ways, it must have been suffocating. Your father, while you loved him, he clearly did not share your aspirations.
Hardly, yeah. In my family, women were to stay in their place because it said so in the Bible. The interpretations given to the Bible,
I'm gay.
And
we don't even go there.
So, my father was a tyrant in every sense of the word. And he made a sharp distinction between my seven brothers and what they could do and me and my sisters. It was quite stark. But I knew this early on. Because I don't know if you recall the passage when I talk about my mother overhearing us deriding my father, okay?
Yes.
And she really got very upset with us and told us never to speak of him in that way again because she would defend him in all matters. But we knew when we were very young that this was an unjust environment and that we had to find a way beyond it. And in fact, seeing my mother and what she endured really is what made me feel that I would never have a life like that under any circumstance. And so yeah, it was, he was something.
Well, and I think your own sort of admonition to yourself is something that also I believe a lot of women have internalized. While they may have loved their mother, their father, were happy they were married, they internalized what they observed and said, I don't want that in my life.
Yes.
And clearly you did.
Yeah.
And I want to get to a couple of questions before we open up to audience questions for you. But you do well. Of course, you're an academic star, and you've got a resume full of extracurricular activities. So it's time for graduate school. First of all, a Black woman, graduate school.
Yeah. Why? Yeah.
I mean, that was pretty radical.
Yeah.
And you become one of these stories that the school that rejected you comes to regret. So you were declined admission at Yale, and you were granted admission at Harvard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You got a Fulbright. Mm-hmm. Your concerns about the money and how you would then see the world obviously were helped significantly by your Fulbright. But have you ever said to any of the Yalies, vindication?
Well, I mean, I don't so much think about things like that. But when they come to me and ask me for advice, I do sometimes think about how erroneous we are in the way that we go about selecting people. And the credence that we give to sameness over difference, and the fact that it was a moment so early in our journey in this country that they could not see a path to somebody like me being relevant. Well, Harvard couldn't see it either, but they at least admitted me. But they told me they didn't really see a future for me.
Well, because you were also, I mean, you were just compounding your radicality. So now here you are, you want to get a master's degree and a PhD in
romance
languages?
Yes.
Like, what Black woman in the 1950s wants to get a PhD in romance languages?
By then it was the 60s and early 70s, so we should have progressed at least far enough for people to say, well, how lovely. They could have, at least said that. But I was weird. Everybody told me that throughout my educational journey. I mean, when I was 17, I got on a Greyhound bus and went to Mexico to live with a Mexican family. And that people thought, oh my, what is, but they all thought I was just bizarre because of the kinds of things that I was doing. But within me, I wanted to know about the world and how people could share in this wonderful enterprise that we have. Not be opposed to each other, not hate each other, but how do we make a world in which people cooperate and have some kind of common purpose and a sense of respect for other people. I was on that quest in the worst possible way because of that stringent segregation that I had experienced. And so going to Mexico and experiencing that, and then going to Wellesley and experiencing that, and then on to France and so forth. So I was just doing these things, and people thought I was mad because I would never do anything very serious. I was a dilettante. I was just going hither, thither, and yon. And it made no sense whatsoever to them what I was doing, especially since I would never be able to get a job in romance languages, right? So
right.
Why was I doing that? Yeah.
Final question for Ruth Simmons. The thing that is missing from this book is anger, recrimination, a sense that you feel any level of accreted resentment that it took so much for you to ultimately become the Ruth Simmons the world knows, loves, admires, adores. What happened to that anger? Where is it? Did it ever exist?
Help me, because I have not understood altogether people's reaction when they say, I should be angrier. I haven't really understood it, because here's the way that I look at all of those things that happened to me. Everybody has a set of experiences that they endure. And what I'm trying to say to my students is, whatever comes to you, there is always something you can take from it, whatever it is. And this will sound perverse. I don't want it to sound perverse, but it will sound perverse. And that is, I couldn't have been the president that I've been if I had not been so marked.
So the suffering.
By segregation, okay? I couldn't be the person that I've been if I had not had the opportunity to be wounded in those ways, because I have so much empathy for my students and what they have to endure. And that's why it has helped me enormously to do those things. I do not want to be mythologized, okay? I was, Gloria, you'll think this is bizarre, I know, as I did, but I'm walking along the road at Smith. I'm driving along the pond, and I notice there's a student who is on crutches trying to get up the hill. So, of course, I stopped the car, and I said, get in. I'll take you to wherever you need to go. And to my horror, she said, oh, no, President Simmons. If you could suffer what you suffered and do what you've done, I can certainly get up this hill on crutches. Well, I don't want that, okay? I don't want that. But I do want people to take very seriously everything that is at hand for them. Sometimes that's a challenge. Sometimes it's a bounty. We don't know. And we also never know what's right around the corner. And often in my life, I've thought the worst possible things that I confronted were the worst possible things. And some of them turned out to be the best possible things I experienced. That's the thing I want people to know. And especially young people today who feel so discouraged, I'm trying to give them some examples of ways to process that journey, the steps along the way, so that they keep going and keep being alert to what can happen, rather than just shutting down and saying, well, I'm just going to be angry because this is not fair. Well, of course it's not fair. But this is a better alternative.
We have time for a few brief questions. And remember, a question is a short sentence that ends with a question mark. So please, there are two microphones. Yes.
Good evening. I'm Michael Myers, and the president of the New York Civil Rights Coalition.
Hello.
My question is about the white teachers in those so-called black schools. Every black school I know always had white teachers. Now, did the black teachers teach the white teachers in terms of teacher attitudes, and how was that manifested in terms of your relationship with them vis-a-vis? And my second question is, which is part of that one, is about your brothers and your sisters. How did they do, your brothers versus your sisters versus your brothers,
Thank you. Academically
and career-wise?
Thank you, Michael.
So in regard to white faculty. I mean, at the time I was at Dillard, it was very common for whites from the North to go south as an act of, as a political action to advance civil rights. So I had the most wonderful teachers at Dillard who were there clearly, and some of them were quite eminent because they were there because they wanted to make a commitment to the struggle. And so the reason I ended up gravitating toward the languages is because I had wonderful teachers in the languages who helped me to understand what that could do for opening up my life. Now, I have to tell you about one teacher who from Yale, who was responsible for my dropping my aspiration to be an actress. And that is, you know, I was in such shock when I got to college, being taught by this Yale professor, who is, you know, coming from a position of Stanislavski, and therefore, the day he asked me, gave my assignment, you know, you'd get on stage and then they'd tell you what you were going to do, improvise. And when he told me to be a chair, I dropped out of theater. I didn't get it. And I don't think he knew how to connect us to that, right? And one of the severe problems of HBCUs at the time is that they fell utterly for the idea that black culture was not worthy of study and teaching. So you couldn't, what was my music course about? Classical music. What were the literature courses about? White writers. And so that was the great travesty for me of that period, is that we were not really sufficiently aware of the depth and the value of what our forebears have produced. So that's that. As for my brothers and sisters, the first generation, the first set of my brothers left home, and three of them joined the military. The others tended to go into factories in Houston and to work as laborers. But they had, what I would say, good lives. They were able to earn money, which by comparison with our life in the rural area was much improved. For my sisters, when they came to Houston, they worked as maids, my two older sisters, as did my mother work as a maid. And so when we got to, the younger ones got to Houston, we were required to go to school every day. That saved us. Otherwise, we would have had to drop out and go to work as well. So, you know, I just happened to be the right age where I escaped that. But today, I mean, I have a very complicated relationship with my siblings. Where I'm constantly, you know, I kind of feel bad because I feel that I really have been so fortunate. But my mistake has been to try to make it up to them. And so I bought them all cars.
No, stop. I've been there.
It will never end. It will never
end. As recently as yesterday.
But they, you know, there's this place where they always want you to remember that you had it much better than they did. And so they remind me all the time. But the thing that's so wonderful about it is that for something like this, the ultimate thing that they do is when I'm with them, they remind me that I'm not all that.
Right. Okay. They both remind you that you're not all that.
Yes.
And then they say, but you're going to pay for dinner.
Yes.
And you're going to
Yeah.
Lend me the money to get a divorce.
I don't
You're
going
to do all the things that we have to do when our siblings who...
I don't mind that. I really don't mind
I resent it deeply.
I love doing things for my family. I really do. I
love doing things for my mother.
Yes.
But that's a different thing than for siblings.
I don't mind it at all. I really don't because here's the thing. All the way through school, my siblings, my family kept me going. The love was always there, always. And it has been the most powerful thing in my life, my relationship to my family. And that's why when I had kids, the one thing that I did, although I was living, you know, in Princeton or in Massachusetts, I would take my children back to Texas so they would get to know their family, because that has been such an anchor for me. So I don't mind doing what I can.
Yes, please.
Good evening. This is just wonderful. I just love the conversation and your stories. It's actually fabulous. Last time I was here was with Darren and Deborah Roberts, the story. And so I know, and this is a great segue into my question, I guess, because generationally, you have similar stories, right? So what would you convey to folks in the 21st century, generationally, some of those same things that you're talking about and depicting still continues to occur? How can we change the dynamics and the narrative of all of that? Thank you. Nadine Johnson, by the way.
Well, I mean, what I continue to say to my students is this evolution is going to go on for a very long time. Don't ever think that you've reached the point where it's solved. You will never see it, okay? And when I talk to groups about diversity, I begin by reminding them this is a journey that you have to work on every day, assiduously, and you will never be finished. And so, again, what I say to my students is, don't be discouraged. This is another period during which the obstacles will seem insurmountable, the pain will be great, and people will still be hateful, and it will hurt. But cry and then get up and keep working, because that's what it's going to take. People who are willing to keep at it and to change the basis on which we live together as human beings, people have to be working at it. Because there are enough people out there who are, oh goodness, evil. And you cannot counter that by turning away or by doing a little bit here and a little bit there. You have to be at it every day. So I've always thought of it that way. Every day that I get up, I'm in this fight in full every day. And that's what I want everybody to be, no matter who they are. If you care about this country, if you care about where we're headed, be in it every day fully. Otherwise, we'll never win.
Final two questions, Janet, and then Carol, please.
Hi, I'm Janet Dewart Bell. You're a good friend of my late husband, Derek Bell.
Yes.
And the question I have for you is, what do you say to your students about the power of education?
Well, I say it's everything, of course. So many people have very rigid and preconceived notions about what matters in education. I'm not an elitist when it comes to education. I've been in elite institutions, but I am fundamentally not an elitist. I believe that education can take place in the darndest places. It can take place in a schoolhouse in Grapeland, Texas, amid farm families, who have nothing at their disposal. It can take place there. It can take place in community colleges where students are striving. And it can take place in state universities. This whole notion of people vying to get into a small number of spaces at certain institutions, I'm appalled by it, to be perfectly honest with you. And I want universities to cut it out. And that's what I say to them all the time, okay? And so I remember when I gave my inaugural address at Brown, I mentioned how wonderful it would be and how necessary it is for Brown to open up to more transfers from community colleges. I think people were appalled by that. And now that I'm advising the president of Harvard, I'm saying the same thing to all of these institutions. Get over yourself. We are part of a community, and we ought to act as if we're part of a community doing the most important thing for this country, and that is educating young people. And we have the capacity to share information. We have the capacity to exchange programs. We have the capacity to interact in all kinds of different ways. But what we do instead is we segment ourselves. That doesn't help our students. So what I say to students is, gain whatever educational experience you can. You are not condemned to a life of penury because you have to go to your local college. That simply isn't true, okay? Go to get whatever education you can and then use that as a stepping stone to whatever higher aspirations you might have. Then I have to say to those higher aspirations, you'd better pay attention to those students and you better make a place for them, because that's probably the single most important thing that this sector can do in the coming years to make this country what it should be. Because right now, so many people feel locked out, and they're beginning to turn their animus not only toward politicians and leaders who failed, but also to education. They're becoming angry about education because it is so closed to them, and we need to open it up more.
Thank you. Carol, last question.
Oh, please let him ask.
The gentleman will have the last question after Carol.
I'll try to be quick, but I have to say that you should all know that Derek Bell gave up his tenured position at Harvard because they would not rise a black woman to tenure. So
yes. He
was very gracious. He was a wonderful example. I just had to say that. I was touched to hear you mention his name.
My
question to you is also related to Harvard, because I understand, Dr. Simmons, that it was because of your conversations with Derek Bach that the university stopped fighting. I think it was Derek Bach who was president at that time. The university stopped fighting African-American studies as an intellectual discipline. I understand it was you who actually made that difference and helped the university think differently and start to build the resources in that department. And I'd like to know, especially in the environment we're in now, what arguments did you use to make that case successfully? That was like the 90s maybe. What arguments? What was the argument that worked? Thank you.
Great question, Carol. Thank you.
Well, it turns out that, you know, in institutions that define themselves as elite, that what they really care about is becoming more elite, more than anything else, right? And so I learned this early on from my days in Princeton, because when Princeton did not want to build Afro-American studies seriously, I started with a yellow pad, and then I listed all of the supremely brilliant African-American scholars that I could think of, and I listed them in order. And then when they gave me the responsibility of recruiting, I started down the list. And I started with Toni Morrison, who was the first. And what I found was that although it was difficult to make that appointment, once she won the Pulitzer, and for God's sake, the Nobel Prize, Princeton talked very differently. Yes, we knew all along, and so forth. I like to remind them of this because, you know, the narrative changes when that happens. And then I had a succession of people like that. So the reason Harvard came to me and asked me if I would help them put this together is because Princeton had become very successful. And of course, the thing to know about elite institutions is they do not want other places to be better than they are. And so you leverage all of the powerful evidence that you have that something is exceptionally good. And so when I chaired the visiting committee for Harvard, I said, well, you know, you've got to do this from the ground up and so forth. They said, well, you know, we need somebody to lead it. And I said, well, I think we know who could lead it, who could do it. And they said, well, who? And I said, well, Skip Gapes probably is the only one who has an ego to match Harvard's ego. And I think he probably could do it. And they said, oh no, we'll never have him as a faculty member. And so that went on for a while. At the time, there was a very powerful dean at Harvard named Henry Rozovsky. And so I pondered, well, how do you convince Harvard that Skip Gates will work at Harvard? So I thought about it, and then I said to Rozovsky, you know, of course, that Skip has been very controversial everywhere else. And that's precisely because he is brilliant and will never fit anywhere but at Harvard. But once he gets to Harvard, he'll feel just like every other faculty member at Harvard. And so they hired him. But again, you cannot be too soft-spoken in these matters. And one of the things that I learned long ago is not to be afraid to get in people's faces and to speak truth to them, even though they don't want to hear it. And so when I say, so I've made a kind of practice out of it. But I also make a practice out of it when it is going to have the greatest impact. I don't waste my time every day whining, okay? It's not worth your time. So when Harvard asked me to do the commencement speech a couple of years ago, I asked myself, well, why are they asking me to give the commencement speech at Harvard? And then I'm president of an African American university. So what is it that they want? I thought about that a while, and I said, of course they want me to say lovely things to their graduates about the wonderful lives they're going to have and so forth, just because they have a Harvard degree. And then I said, well, of course I can't do that. And so what I chose to do is to say, one, to the students, they had an obligation, given what they had had access to think about all of those children who will never have any capacity to do, to have the education that they've had. That if they do not care about those children, they have not won their laurels. It's only when they care about those children that they will have won their laurels. And then I turned to Harvard and said, Harvard, you have been rich for centuries, and your wealth has been compounding for centuries. And you have African American universities that have been impoverished for a century, and you have done nothing to help them. It is time for you and your community to step up and welcome these institutions into higher education and do something to help. So you have to pick your moment, and hopefully it's a moment where you can embarrass people a little bit. But when you do that, be careful, because, you know, every time I've tried to do this, they've come back and said, okay, well, now, since you've done that, you need to help us. Okay, so be careful with that. But otherwise, listen, our voices are the single most important thing that we have. We don't have enough economic power. We don't have enough political power, really, even that. But we have our voices. And we can call out practices that are inimical to the kind of justice that we seek. We can do that. And when we fail to use our voices, we are empowering the continuation of the same old thing. So thank you for speaking out in the way that you do. Because it makes all the difference in the world.
I do have a coda, though, to your point that you understand very well about what wealthy universities love. I would only add that they love money.
Yes.
And one of the reasons for the support following on your leadership to the actual permanent instantiation was because foundations like the Ford Foundation and Mellon and others gave chairs the initial endowment. As Skip said, when he got the initial endowment from the Ford Foundation for the Du Bois Institute, they started to listen in a different way.
Yes,
because
they did.
Because a black man raised his own money through his own network and had a gatekeeping, anointing institution, whether we like it or not, big foundations often are when it comes to the academy. And to Skip's credit, because we know Skip is Skip, he does understand that to these institutions, money matters.
Yes.
And it is why he has been, in part, in addition to being a great scholar, such a success. Just as you were as an incredible fundraiser at Brown, at Smith, at Prairie View, which until you arrived didn't even have a development office. And so we cannot underestimate the power of capital.
Yeah, unquestionably, absolutely.
Please, you were going to introduce our final question. Please, sir.
Hi, Ruth.
Hi.
First, I want to thank you for the book. I want to thank you for this session, and I want to thank the Ford Foundation for this session. This was impeccable. Yeah. My question is two-part. Was there a deeply personal need or angst that drove you to write the book? And what is your family saying about the book? What are they saying about the way you characterize them?
You know, great question. Thank you.
University president.
Please tell us who he is, then, if you
say a little bit about yourself, please.
I think of myself as her favorite son. she is my mentor. I worked for her at Prairie View, and it was the best thing I've ever done in my life. I'm president of State University of New York at Old Westbury on Long Island because of her.
Like so many others who you have mentored who have gone on to do great things and, of course, be presidents of universities themselves.
Yeah. Thank you, Tim. It's wonderful, wonderful to see you. What impelled me to write this is what impels us all, I suppose, at some point. It's to understand fully who we are. And why we do what we do. And I had this in my mind for a long time, but I hadn't fully processed it, I think. And the older I got and the more questions I got from my students, Ruth, why did this happen? How did you get to do that? And why did you choose to do that? I found myself answering those questions. That were being put to me. And I thought, well, you know, perhaps it would be simpler if I just wrote about it. And yet when I sat down to write it, you know, I confronted the awful things you have to confront. And that is, will you tell the truth in full? Will you mince words? And so forth. And so that was the agony of it, was trying to think about how to write about things, especially about people. I knew this was not the book people wanted from me. They want the tell-all book from my academic career, and not a book about my childhood. But my students often really want to know how I came to be who I am, because they're struggling around the same kinds of issues, you know, first generation students and so forth, and they just want to know more and all the time of, well, what about this, what about that? And so when I sat down to write it, I realized it was too ambitious a project for me, because I started it when I was at Brown, and I didn't have time to finish it. So I had a book advance, and I sent the I returned the book advance and said, I just can't do it. I don't have time during my work at Brown. And then along came COVID. My agent, Wendy Strothman, is here. She helped me through a process. Maybe she thought that this would put the fire under me. She introduced me to my wonderful editor, who then took me in hand and pounded it into me that this had to be done well. I had to, most of all, I had to finish it. But we're good friends now, aren't we, David? Yeah. So thank you, David, for everything you did. But he was convinced enough that there was something in it to offer. And his belief helped me finally finish it. The only problem that I have with him, which I'll have to deal with at some point, is he's talking about the next book and what that, you know, that's what editors do, right? They want to, well, when is the next one going
well,
to be
Well, that's
started?
What editors of authors who write great books do.
So
please join me in thanking the inimitable, indefatigable, amazing Ruth Simmons.
Thank you.